Hi, this is Alec from Groovy Entertainment. Today we got another record to play for you. Today's record is Transformer, The Attack of the Decepticons from 1985. So let's get started.
Peninsula, a squadron of doom hurtled through the coming dawn, their jet engines screaming.
This is Decepticon plane Thundercracker reporting. Approaching target at maximum attack speed, Mighty Megatron. Contact in key minus 5 seconds. We shall obliterate the oil storage dump as ordered. We will reduce it to nothing more than a smoldering mass of twisted metal. And every puny current base defender will soon be begging for mercy.
Decepticon planes swept in low and fast with the rising sun at their backs, spewing the full weight of their destructive power. The null rays and laser-guided missiles ravage the desert storage depot, tearing it apart with thousands of explosions. Continued. Megatron, the depraved Decepticon leader, and Soundwave, his aide, monitored the command channel.
Listen to that, Master. Thundercracker is mad with battle fever.
All Decepticons should only exhibit Thundercracker's dedication to our ultimate purpose. Possession of all the fuel on this pathetic planet so we can completely annihilate every Autobot in existence. Then, our domination of the universe will be total and unchallenged. Do you understand, Soundwave?
Absolutely, Mighty Megatron.
Then it is not necessary that I rack open your tape-filled chest to make my point.
No, Master, it's not. I'm certain that... Wait, look. Just as you predicted, the Autobots are rising to the bait. They're mounting a massive counterattack that will take most of their force and divert their attention while we go about our main mission.
Megatron's alloy metal skin shone dully in the greenish glow of the computer monitor.
Excellent.
He and Soundwave were in the command pod of the massive Decepticon submersible storage vat off the coast of Africa, near the island of Madagascar. The VAT's powerful suction drives were delivering the fatal blow to the sixth supertanker in less than a month. And the sudden displacement of such a huge quantity of oil was causing the ship to break up.
Mayday! Mayday! This is the super tanker Orion. We are taking on water. Location, 10 degrees south latitude, 59 degrees east longitude. Mayday! Mayday!
Although forced to deal with the cowardly Decepticon attack on the desert depot, Optimus Prime, the Autobot leader, had not dropped his vigilance or his awareness of the unlimited evil capacity of Megatron's imagination. But he and his aide, Prowl, could only follow the Decepticon strategy with helpless frustration.
Did that break, Prowl?
Of course, Chief. It's stored in your secondary banks when you're ready for it.
It seems our sinister adversaries are at it again. And successfully, too. But there's nothing we can do to save that ill-fated ship. Not this time. There's just not enough time or equipment available.
We're bobbing like a cork. On full ballast. Mayday! Mayday!
Are you sure the Autobots aren't picking up his distress signal?
Of course not, mighty Megatron. The new jamming system is far too advanced.
And the oil?
All on board, all-powerful one. Every precious drop.
Megatron turned slowly around and leaned over Soundwave's shoulder with as much grace as can be expected from anything so very large. They both stared with a glazed satisfaction at the flickering video monitor before them.
Why, look. That pitiful little humanoid vessel is almost underwater now.
Clearly broken in two amidship. Shall we dive, Master?
At once! Half my force are standing idle for want of this blasted black oil. Set a course for Refinery Sector 90 and be quick about it. You know how badly we need this.
Optimus Prime and Prowl listened as the signal from the Decepticon submersible grew weaker. It dove toward the deep North Atlantic Trench where the refinery station lay.
Unchanging, unending greed, Chief. A curse on the technology that set their first gear in motion.
It proves what we Autobots have known all along. Mere progress is not enough. It is really a question of what these carbon-based life forms call morality.
A totally foreign concept to a mecha-cultural mind.
But strangely appealing. Don't you think so, Prowl?
Appealing? But so far, unconvincing. If it hasn't worked for them, what makes you think it would work for us?
But it has worked for them, Prowl. After all, we are here. Whenever and wherever evil raises its ugly head, right marches out to meet it. Without our presence, this planet would have been bled dry of all its natural resources months ago. No, Prowl, we share the same instincts. But the Earthlings seem to have found a name for it. Morality. I need much more data on this subject. Sophocles, Thomas Jefferson, Gandhi.
Within milliseconds, Optimus Prime began processing. A skilled leader needs all the information, and Optimus Prime had been at this for a very long time. His battle with the Decepticons began millions of years before the first single-celled life had stirred in the warm tidal pools on the still-cooling volcanic shores of Earth. Millennia ago, his metallic planet, Cybertron, had erupted into a terrible civil war when the Decepticons rose up and attacked the peaceful Autobot society. And now, that war had spread across space to Earth, where Megatron, the evil Decepticon leader, sworn to wipe out all Autobots once and for all, will let nothing stand in his way. Certainly not the life of the planet.
Tell me, Prowl, you were always so full of clever ideas. Do you have anything in your logic center to cover this situation?
Obviously. A simple attack on the refinery is not sufficient, Chief. We need to strike deeper. A steady supply of pure new oil will revitalize Megatron's force.
Pure? That's intriguing. There is a purity about it when it leaves the Earth, isn't there?
But it needn't be quite so pure when the Decepticons obtain it.
Explain yourself.
Well, Megatron is quite vain, and his sense of superiority at the moment won't allow him to even consider that we could know of his actions. The Decepticons would have no reason to suspect a special super tanker, one that was carrying a load of oil that was laced with a powerful, corrosive acid. But how would we keep it from eating through the ship's hull? One problem at a time, Chief. All things are possible. Megatron was not given to long discussions. Truly great minds bore easily, and Megatron had a truly great and sophisticatedly evil mind. While his vessel was still discharging the life-giving fuel the Decepticons needed, he was already planning his next attack.
I am pleased the Earthlings do not discourage easily. One would think after the loss of 6 super tankers in a row, they might cancel the shipments, but no. They need as badly as we do. Tomorrow, the Colossus, the world's largest new super tanker, will make her maiden voyage.
And we shall be there to greet her master. Think of it. 5 million barrels of high-grade crude in one gulp.
Delicious. Absolutely delicious. They are prepared at once. Set a course for the Gulf of Oban. The Colossus sails at dawn.
So far, the Decepticons and their evil leader Megatron had managed to confound the efforts of Optimus Prime and the Autobots to stop their attacks. 6 super tankers destroyed in less than a month, and their precious cargo of oil carried away to Decepticon refineries deep under the Atlantic Ocean. And growing Decepticon fuel reserves could only spell doom for anyone who stood in the way of their plans for domination of the universe. And it was not over yet. Megatron had vicious designs on the largest super tanker ever built, the Colossus. It was gigantic, even by Cybertronic standards, larger than most commercial airports, and powered by 2 nuclear reactors. The great ship rested deep in the azure blue water as it plowed through the Gulf of Oman on a southwest bearing that would take her around the Cape of Good Hope and outward into the Atlantic. Of course, the crew was nervous. It is difficult to rationalize away the disappearance of 6 super tankers in less than a month. But they were larger, and the new fracture-proof alloy in the hull, which the Autobots had conveniently arranged for Earth scientists to discover, made the ship unsinkable. A few crew members had complained of a funny smell in the cargo as they loaded the crude, but no one in command took them seriously. Time was money, and a peculiar odor was not going to hold up the wheels of the world economy. And this cargo needed to reach its destination in more ways than they knew. The corrosive acid in the oil would deliver a wrenching blow to the Decepticons. Optimus Prime was sure of it.
If our intelligence is accurate, the Decepticons should attack shortly after nightfall.
We have 2 waves of Autobots standing by at Base Epsilon. They will scramble as soon as the Decepticons attack the Colossus, Chief.
And in the Decepticon submersible's command pod, Megatron was almost ready to explode from his own cleverness.
Prepare to ascend. We are just beneath the Colossus now. Are the macro siphon tubes depressurized?
Approaching red line now, Master.
Prepare to attach the laser auger and penetrate the Colossus hull. And be quick about it. At any moment, another brave Decepticon warrior could grind to a halt for want of fuel.
The Decepticon attack was so quiet, it passed unnoticed on board the Colossus. The moment the suction tubes were attached to the bottom of the tanker, Megatron began draining away the oil. And with it, the corrosive acid. The empty Decepticon storage vat began to fill up, and the Autobots monitored the flow of every fatal gallon.
Shall we attack now, Chief? Just a while longer, Prowl. I want that acid to sink in. I want it to permeate the entire Decepticon system before we make a move.
On board the Decepticon vessel, Megatron and his evil crew were unaware that the fuel they were so greedily sucking away would soon begin to take effect. It was just a matter of minutes before the corrosive acid in the oil would start to cripple their submersible.
How many gallons so far, Soundwave?
Over 600,000, mighty Megatron. And there's still room for more.
Then take it! I want it all! Every last drop.
Suddenly, the red warning lights on the submersible's command console began to flash and the abandoned ship klaxon went off.
What's going on? If something's gone wrong to jeopardize this load of crude, I'll see to it that you're nothing but scrap metal, Soundwave.
Patience, Master. Please, I'm checking everything.
I have no patience with moronic, outdated machines such as you.
But Soundwave's computer search could not detect the source of the problem for one very simple reason. They were the source of the problem themselves. Everything, even the computer. From the first moment the poisoned fuel was pumped on board, the corrosive acid contained began to eat its way through the metal and circuitry of the Decepticon submersible. It was just a matter of time before the entire craft would malfunction. Drained of half its fuel, the supertanker was riding dangerously high in the water, but its superior metal hull prevented the ship from breaking up and foundering. By now, the first wave of Autobots was closing in and reporting to Optimus Prime.
We are over the target, Chief. Shall we commence the electromagnetic lift?
At once! Lift the Colossus from the water! I have a feeling our Decepticon friends will be right beneath it.
As the squadron of Autobots hovered over the supertanker, the electromagnetic waves began to pulse downward, gripping the steel hull of the Colossus. The crew looked on, stunned but safe, as the Autobots moved upward, lifting the gigantic ship out of the Atlantic waters. Soon the Colossus was hundreds of feet in the air. Far beneath it, fatally damaged and bobbing on the surface, floated the stricken Decepticon submersible. On board, Megatron screamed with fury.
I find you idiots! The Autobots are upon us!
We're trying, Megatron, but all our equipment is failing. Even our backup systems are malfunctioning.
Then take out those Autobots! Fire them! Do something, you mechanical idiot!
Roger, Megatron! But what? Nothing's functioning.
Try the Vulcan force field, you cassette stop tin box.
Roger, Master.
But as Soundwave punched in the force field activator, it only set up a thunderous vibration throughout the Decepticon craft.
But now, we're going to come apart, Master. I'd better shut down.
Shut up and stand aside.
Megatron opened the pod hatch and loosed a round from his fusion cannon, knocking out two Autobots.
Take that, you fools! You're no match for Megatron!
Two more Autobots quickly replaced the others, but Megatron took them out, too.
Join your miserable companion, simpleton!
But even more Autobots arrived, letting loose a shower of firepower. Megatron quickly ducked back inside and slammed the hatch shut.
Curse their Autobot drive shafts!
Master, we're going to sink! I can do nothing. Our controls are useless. What's wrong? This has never happened before.
The oil! It must be the oil. They have poisoned the crude. Check Optimus Prime, but never checkmate. This is but one battle, and we will fight on many more fronts until I crush you and your kind. Because I, and I alone, will control Earth's resources. The Earthlings have abused them so badly, they will never miss them. Prepare the command pod for emergency ejection, Soundwave. And hurry, you bumbling bag of guns.
The Decepticon command pod, with its own source of unpolluted fuel, had just cleared concussion range when the huge explosion struck. Autobots' thermal missiles found the heart of the storage vat and the heat of their warheads set off a chemical chain reaction between the oil and the acid, resulting in a tremendous explosion. The huge fireball heated the belly of the Colossus and reached the Autobots far above. However, with the supertanker still safely in their magnetic grip, the Autobots raced on toward America. While inside the ship, bewildered and amazed, the crew held on. This was the ride of their lives. Then, up ahead, through the clearing clouds of dawn, they could see the twinkling lights of New York Harbor and the bright torch of the Statue of Liberty. They lowered the ship with surprising ease into the calm waters off the Verrazano Bridge, seen only by the keen eye of the JFK radar tower and one lone Staten Island fisherman.
Crowd, you will see to it that the gentlemen at both locations have no memory of what they witnessed this morning.
Of course, Chief. All radar information will have been auto-erased by now as well.
And our fellow Autobots?
Turning to base, Chief.
Sadly, we both know the Decepticons too well to think they will not strike again.
And thousands of miles away, in the hot deserts of northern Mexico, an oil exploration crew for a large petroleum company was hard at work. After all, as any Decepticon or Autobot can tell you, oil is hard to find. The foreman shouted to his crew.
Hey, man, oh man, did you feel that shock? The main bit must have struck something mighty hard. Come on, bring her up. Bring her up.
As the rig lifted the drill bit up from far beneath the desert floor, the crew grew wide-eyed with amazement. Half of the super-strong, case-hardened steel bit was sheared off.
Will you look at that?
That bit snapped clean off. I've never seen anything like it in all my years working in the field.
Of course he had never seen anything like it before, because nothing like it had occurred on Earth before. The bit had not snapped off. It had been seared off by the powerful lasers protecting the perimeter of the underground Decepticon fortress Gamma. And the battle continues.
So that was Transformers, The Attack of the Decepticons from 1985. Now, this is what the front cover looked like, and this is what the back cover looked like. So please like, subscribe, share, and comment, and have a groovy day. And we'll have another video coming out real soon.